Good day, my friends. In the previous video, we discussed the needed activity volume in the lifespan of a sport horse across career stages. Today, we will discuss the second element of a training plan, which is workloads in a mix. Workloads in a mix is one of my favorite subjects because it is so much diversity and almost infinite variations. Tactics from workloads are covered at a great length in books like authored by James Phillips and Wilhelm Müller, video series by Rainer Klimke, Konrad Schumacher, Kyra Kirkland, Tim Stockdale, Ingrid Klimke, Lisa Wilcox, many others. And in numerous private berate and trainer channels on YouTube and in public aggregators like www.dressagetrainingonline.com. What is a workload? Workload is a training tactic. Workload is a distinctly defined training activity that develops specific skills in a sport horse towards progression as a happy and healthy athlete. Berater offers a sport horse various mixes of workloads in calendar periods within each career stage. So that is the job of a berater. Berater defines, designs, and offers a sport horse various mixes of workloads in calendar periods within each career stage. I highlighted. I almost sound like a broken record. But this is responsibility that is rarely recognized by riders and horse owners. It's a berater's job to do this design. If the mixes of workloads are not carefully planned in calendar periods, then you are using almost exclusively relational approach to sport horse development and no structural approach. If you are not using a structural approach, then you cannot be a berater. Principles. The principles of workloads are: workloads can be single, there can be combinations of different workloads. There is a principle of layering workloads one on top of another. And this layering is very interesting and requires experience. So watching all the videos on tactics in workloads of and reading about them in the books is fascinating. How trainers and berators do the layering. Example of layering can be very simple. During braking, the horse has learned to go on a lunge line and then a rider is added to a saddle. So we've added weight and the biomechanics of a human body on top. That is an example of layering. Another example of layering, the horse knows how to go on driving reins, on long lines, and if we add a sledge or a car tire behind the horse to drag, that is example of layering. Another example of layering, the horse has learned to jump or to go in canter over a ground pole. We let the horse go through a jump chute on its own, but over small axes. That is an example of layering. So it is a progression. We add some new elements. We a little bit merge and combine. We layer workloads one on top of another. Once a horse demonstrates good understanding and comfort and joy in performing at the current level. Then there is grouping. Grouping is when we group workloads within a day, within a week, within a month, within a sprint. Grouping takes a longer calendar period. Combinations of different workloads or single workload happen within one training session. Layering can happen within one training session or can be spread in a longer calendar period. Now, intensity. Workloads can be classified, sorted by intensity. Essentially, we have 8 low to moderate intensity workloads for sport horses, and we have another 8 moderate to high intensity workloads. So in total, we have 16 workloads for a generalist sport horse. Discipline amplifies workloads. This is a very important and simple thing that seemingly why would we even stop on it and why would we even talk about it. But funny enough, if you ask a common rider what is the difference between a discipline and workload, they wouldn't be able to give a clear answer. If people cannot give a clear answer, that means that they do not have a clear understanding. They don't have an idea. So let's bring some clarity here. A workload is a distinctly defined training activity that develops specific skills in a sport horse towards progression as a happy and healthy athlete. We already have given this definition in the slide before. There are 16 workloads total for a generalist sport horse. All 16 workloads are enhancing for a sport horse that is or will be specialized in a certain discipline. That's important. All 16 workloads are enhancing for a sport horse that is or will be specialized in a certain discipline. Discipline. What is a discipline? Discipline is when a sport horse talents from select workloads out of those 16. They are compelled to be demonstrated in a competition environment under certain sport rules and regulations defined by equestrian federations and associations. One more time. Discipline, we subject the horse to a sport discipline. When a sport horse talents from select workloads out of those 16 are compelled to be demonstrated in a competition environment. Let's take United States as an example. United States Equestrian Federation, USEF, and Federal Equestre Internationale, FEI, recognize 6 international competition disciplines that stem organically, I repeat, 6 international competition disciplines that stem organically from a generalist sport horse development. These are dressage, eventing, show jumping, endurance, vaulting, and combined driving. USEF and FEI also recognized as a separate branch, not organically stemming from generalist sport horse development, but as a separate branch, paraequestrian and reining. And these disciplines are very different. They have very different principles and focus. In paraequestrian, it's a focus on a human, more so. Human and human abilities are taken into consideration with greater care, and reining has very different training principles, performance, tech, everything. In addition, USEF recognizes 10 national disciplines that are logically different. I need to repeat. USEF recognizes 10 national disciplines that are logically different from the generalistic sport horse development principles in the listed above 6 international disciplines. So 10 national disciplines in the US are logically different. They are different branches. To me, personally, it is a question if those quote-unquote national disciplines should exist and be regulated as disciplines. Let's leave it to some other time. But for now, this is how it is. We have 6 international competition disciplines that stem organically from a generalist sport horse development: dressage, eventing, show jumping, endurance, vaulting, combined driving. So looking closer at workloads for a generalist sport horse, we look for unmounted workloads. These workloads have low to moderate intensity, and this is typical work for young remount horse on training years 1 and 2. On training year 1, unmounted workloads constitute about 95% of all training time. This is work in hand, work on a lunge line, free lunging at liberty without the lunge line and equipment, or maybe with side reins and third single but without lunge line, long lining, lunging and long lining over ground poles and cavalettes, dragging a sledge or a tire, which is what can be done on any footing and in any time of the year, whether it's rain or snow, free jumping in a chute, long lining ground driving in the open space, in the field, and on the training track. This is excellent test for a horse's obedience in the open spaces. And driving a cart, a very light cart. The other set of workloads for a generalist sport horse are mounted workloads. They are of mostly moderate intensity. They could spike up to high intensity, but for young remount and old remount horse training years, it is advisable to keep them in moderate intensity. We can see on the left-hand side layering of the two workloads for braking. The horse is on the lunge line on a cavesson, and the rider is added on top, mounted. It is some jumping work in the open field, flat work in the dressage court, work in the open fields and hills, stadium jumping in the enclosed arena, riding with the music. You can see the black horse in the center with the music book. Some very basic cross-country jumping, riding at night with projectors to prepare your horse for big competitions and horse presentations, riding in the open water on the beach and jumping into open water, riding in a dressage court, pas de deux, as a group, and also jumping as a pair. We start these mounted activities, they being introduced to a young remount horse training year 2, and then we fully embrace them at old remount horse training years 1 and 2. So by the end of the 4 years of remount training, your horses can do a whole lot. and stay healthy. From remont to discipline specialization as developing horse. Let's look at this path. Workload variety, complexity and intensity increase gradually in 4 remont horse years on the left, 2 young remont and 2 old remont, and then 4 developing horse years on the right. In developing horse years, more focus happens on some workloads demonstrated in a show ring once a specialization is chosen. For example, the horse here makes a transition from being a generalist to working more in dressage, in jumping, or in cross country, or the horse completely transitions to driving, or the horse goes as an endurance horse or a vaulting horse. Still, unmounted, we can see that unmounted workloads are a part of the full training program during developing horse years. We cannot get rid of them. They must be there to keep the horse healthy. This is a Beretta alert. Mix of workloads in specialized training years is getting thinner, and it is our human fault. Specialized breeding does not cancel the need for holistic mix of workloads for young and old remont and developing horse, as well as for schoolmaster and retired horse. People, specialized breeding does not cancel the need for holistic mix of workloads. Specialized breeding, like breeding for jumping, or breeding for dressage, or breeding for eventing, or breeding for carriage driving, or breeding for endurance. Specialized breeding only promotes natural talents to certain workloads out of all 16. It does not mean that if it is a breeding for endurance, then with that horse, you do only one workload, which is 30 days of breaking with a cowboy, and then you do only one workload, which is endurance on trails and roads and fields and mountains. No. It doesn't mean that if this horse is bred for jumping, then you start jumping that horse in a chute, then you add a person on top, and then you continue riding on the saddle mounted all your jumping combinations and courses, and that's all you do. No. Specialized breeding only promotes natural talents to certain workloads, but the horse still needs to be exposed to all 16 workloads to develop holistically in all dimensions and have the highest chance to graduate as a developing horse healthy. So, a summary. A sport discipline is demonstration of sport horses' abilities in one or a few workloads in a competition environment, assuming a sport horse is trained in a full mix of workloads. Training in a full mix of workloads tests breeding weaknesses and helps close the feedback loop with the breeders to avoid them in the future. What happens if we do not expose our young horses to training in all workloads? We enable dark spots in breeding. We then enable horses' weaknesses that they have not had once they were fully generalist horses in the breeding approach. We must train horses in all workloads and give breeders feedback on weaknesses to help breeders avoid them in the future. So this is how workloads funnel looks like. in a lifespan. I've added percentages at the bottom that indicate how much training time we want to allocate to unmounted workloads. So you can see that 10% work unmounted is the least proportion during school master finishing years. And that makes sense, right? Because that is the time where we take risk and we push the horse's performance all the way to the limits and over the limits in a selected discipline. But before schoolmaster finishing stage and after it, the percentage of time allocated will allocate more time to unmounted workloads. This is necessary, guys. Guys, this is necessary. I've worked with and helped to recover and rehab and fix so many broken project horses. And I may tell you that if these horses would be subjected to a holistic mix of all mounted and unmounted workloads, and if unmounted workloads would be in a fair presence in their overall training plan, these horses would be well and they would continue their careers to the sheer joy of their owners and riders. I would say it's a 99% reason for all my project horses that I helped to rehab why the injuries happened in the first place, or why they had a mental checkout. It's just a misbalance of the training routines, of the training workloads. That's why I'm created this slide, and I want you to look at this slide, to study every picture and memorize it and have it in your head so that you could look at the horse that you have in training right now and you could benchmark and make necessary adjustments. I want your horses, guys, to be very, very healthy, and I want you to enjoy your time with the horses. With the urbanization of life, longer roads, more traffic, it is a fact that horse owners and riders spend less time in a saddle per week, which is a problem. This is a problem. And my recommendation to allocate more time in the horse's training to unmounted workloads kind of goes against, it's contradictory to the goal of having more saddle time for a rider. However, guys, there are different ways to get more saddle time. And these ways to get more saddle time include cooperation in the barn, owning or having exposure to a portfolio of horses. But we should not strive to ride one poor horse that we have in ownership 7 days a week to get more saddle time. If we do that, if we are like bulldogs biting to that horse and only train mounted all the time, that poor horse breaks. We can pay vet bills. We can put horses into layup and then bring back with anticipation to ride that poor horse again 6-7 days a week. This is a road to nowhere. But look at this diagram on this slide. If you follow it, your horse will be healthy and will have less downtime. And if a horse has less injuries and less downtime and is more cooperative with you, that will mean that in total, over the time of your ownership with this horse, you actually will have more saddle time than if you would push the horse to have more mounted work per week and would also have breaks because of the mental overload or injury. Okay? I'm looking forward for your comments below the video. Please leave me comments. Tell me your story. How did it happen for you? Good or bad? Okay? So a little bit of taxonomy, creating a mix of workloads. Single workload can constitute 100% of a training session. Easy. For example, you hop on a horse and you go into the field and you hack in the field and you do only walk, trot, canter in the field and you come back from the field right into the stable. That was a single workload. Another example, you take the horse on a lunch line on a cavesson, so single, side reins. You take the horse into the arena, into the field, into the round pen. You lunge the horse for 15-20 minutes. You bring the horse back to the barn. That was a single workload that constituted 100% of a training session. All's fine. Then there is layering of exercises and blueprints within one workload. Complexity of layering increases as training progresses. Let's take an example with the field. We layer exercises. So in the field, we also add a little hill or a little ditch or a little water pond and the horse goes through it. So that's where we've done a layering of exercises. We can, for example, in the field, ride the horse in brisk trot or canter, but then after a break in walk, we can take the horse on the bit, rebalance it on the haunches, and offer a horse to do a few dressage blueprints right there on the grass using an imaginary cord. Yeah? Another example, we take the horse on a lunge line. We lunge the horse on a flat and then we offer a horse to go over some ground poles or over cavaletti. That's layering. Yeah? If we do ground driving, we can do a lot of lateral work on long lines, but then we can also spin a horse on a circle and we can start walking dressage blueprints. We can start doing loops and serpentines and transitions and everything that we do in the dressage court and the test, we can do as ground driving. So that would be another example of layering. So within one workload, we've done layering of exercises and blueprints. Combinations of workloads create a tactical training mix within a day, a week, a sprint, a training year, and a career stage. This is the combinations of workloads is what a berater must know and must skillfully apply. Without this knowledge, without knowing working consciously, with making notes in your little notebook, typing on your phone, typing somewhere in the Word document or in Excel, without running your diary, you're not a berater if you're not doing that. Then you're just a hobby rider. Even if what you do is a fantastic shoulder in and you put flying changes on a horse in just 30 days, and the horse goes like a Swedish clock. So the ability to create and manage combinations of workloads that create a tactical mix within a day, a week, a sprint, a training year, and career stage is what creates a berater. Maybe because this subject has not been covered in a great detail, in a focused way, we don't have berators in North America. We have riders, we have training instructors who teach how to do a shoulder in and flying changes. We have professional riders who participate in open classes and they demonstrate their tactical skills or they go training level or prelim in eventing, or they go in a stadium jumping course. And what a joy to be in a jump off. we don't have berators. And we do have a term coach. When we fill the sign-up sheet for competitions, we do have a term coach. But what is in the coach profession that is even less defined than what is a berator. So hopefully, equestrian profession pyramid will evolve pretty quickly in North America as well, and will catch up with the European roles and responsibilities curriculum. But for now, we all are riders and horse owners. We are trainers or instructors. And we need to know that combination of workloads, the skill of creation, the combination of workloads in, as a tactical training mix is what we must catch up, all of us, all millions of riders. Grouping of workloads combinations into training themes fitting a specific horse and rider in their career stages, body condition and stamina, and availability of training areas and competition facilities. This is another area of expertise that it's wonderful if a berator has it. In a riding instructor, following US terms, must have it. And this is what a coach absolutely has or should have. So, variety of the workload combinations help a horse keep alert and interested. And it's been a supportive fact that eventing and combined driving horses are known to be the happiest and, surprise, surprise, often the healthiest despite high training strains. This fact, this last bullet point about eventing and combined driving horses is a testimony, is a validation, is a proof point that horses from all other discipline specialization and all generalist horses, guys, expose them to all 16 workloads, training workloads, and balance mounted and unmounted. Please do. I will be excited to hear your success stories. There are principles that influence workload combinations and themes. Pencil them down or take a screenshot of this slide with your computer or with your phone. Managing training themes and activities intensity and volume is the essence of a training plan, design and execution. Horse is the first priority in training plan design and execution. I've had this conversation many times with the riders during training sessions or when I would clinic or run master classes. The rider would say, oh, I cannot do this, I cannot do that. And I reply, we are not focusing on you. Your horse is our priority for training plan design and execution. You, human, just fit into that plan. Human is, of course, a closed second priority, but a second. People with anthropocentric bias are better off in non-equestrian sports. This is a very foreign concept for many people. It's very foreign. It doesn't make them smile. It makes their face look bad. For those people, it's better to pursue non-equestrian sports. Guys, we don't need to be miserable where we don't need to be. And we see a lot of cases when parents bring their kids who naturally are little selfish beasts because they're kids. Because parents revolve around themselves, they expect the horse revolve around them. And these kids cry and they do not want to be on a horse, and the trainers just make it happen because parents pay them money. We don't want this to happen. There should be qualifying requirements. Which human beings and which kids qualify to come to the barn and touch a horse? It should not be their parents' will or this latest fashion of my community, of my block. Everybody goes to the barn, I will go to the barn too. The horse is a tool for me. Doesn't work like that. Human is in training because it's a horse rider combination. A human is a glass ceiling for a horse. If a rider or a trainer are not working for a horse needs a reassignment to new management hands. That's just how it is. Another piece of confusion about creating a training plan for a sport horse is in taxonomy, how we call a person on a horse. We call it a rider. Well, a rider is somebody who sits in a saddle. So that creates a bias that if you are not in a saddle, then you are not a rider. That the rider is somebody who's supposed to be in the saddle. And if our horse is in unmounted workload today, or in a rehab, or in a scheduled time off on a well-deserved vacation, then we feel kind of like sad, which is not true. It's not supposed to be like that. Us being on the ground does not mean that we are any bad and that we relate to a horse in a lesser way. So this English word rider drives us a little bit emotionally in the wrong direction. The word equestrian, or the word berater, or the word trainer, or the word coach, or the word breeder, or the word owner, are much more suitable, and they, in essence, assume eligibility of all workloads, all training activities. People are around horses. But the word rider, I don't like it. It's confusing and misleading and creates false expectations in equestrian community. First, young remont year assumes only unmounted workloads. Horses must be at least 25 months old to experience first super brief mountings for a few minutes and walk with a very light rider. See, rider again, with a very light berator, which at the beginning of their second young remont horse here. So very light human mounts a horse for a few minutes in walk at the beginning of their second young remont horse training year. Mounted workloads can be introduced to horses that successfully completed the first young remont training year and demonstrated that they can physically and mentally carry weight on backs during first brief mountings on a lunge. There are bloodlines where horses mature mentally or physically or both with a delay. I should probably not mention the bloodlines, the names of the stallions and the breeds, but I would say probably at least 25% of modern breeding of foals belong to bloodlines which mature with a great delay. For those horses, first mounting should, even if it happens during second young remont horse year, really riding walk trot canter can happen only on the third training year. They're so skinny, they're so gangly, their attention span is so small, they have ADHD, they spook, they react. There are lots of horses like that, and it relates to Hanoverian, stud book, Oldenburg, Dutch, Danish, Swiss, Swedish, Russian, Spanish, even Frisians, lots and lots and lots of breeds. Just within each breed, there is a percentage of horses, there are bloodlines that mature late. So this pattern, this schedule is for average horses that mature fast enough. So it's about 75% of horses can go on the schedule. Full variety of unmounted workloads should be a part of training themes. That's our last principle on this slide. Full variety of unmounted workloads should be a part of training themes for every career stage and in every of the 6 USEF and FEI specialized international disciplines: dressage, eventing, jumping, combined driving, endurance, and bolting. So today we talked about the second element of a sport horse training plan, which is workloads in a mix. We did not cover the tactics of these workloads because they are covered at a great length in so many publications, videos, and online resources that we would be just repeating what's already out there. And that was not the purpose of this presentation. Berater alert is that in many training yards, horses are not exposed to all 16 workloads during their training, especially during their generalized training as young and old remount and developing horses before specialization begins. I want all of you to memorize this chart. How we balance mounted and unmounted workloads for sport horses across their lifespan and career stages.